dotards who might walk through a door confused and bewildered. Careful. Some people, a large portion, did storm their way in and were fighting cops. There's a video I watched from the FBI where, like, a guy grabs a cop's mask and is shaking his head violently, and I'm like, that's messed up. Or that guy should get arrested. Don't do that. But there are some people who are bewildered, befuddled, and just, like, walked through an open door waving a little American flag while the cops waved to them and guided them in the building. And the FBI is like, should tell us who these people are. We're going to arrest all of them. You ain't seen nothing yet. And then Antifa shows up and burns down a bunch of buildings, and they're like, yeah, it's all right. It's all right. It's not all right. It's not all right. The system is completely broken. The cult is taking over. And they're, and with Biden in power as president, going after Giuliani, oh, there it is. So people like to say, I wonder if the reason why many of these lefties are like, don't talk too much civil war is because they don't want you to, they don't want people to realize we're in one. We are in a cold civil war. That cold doesn't mean it's not happening. Cold means it's not being fought with live ammunition. When the government steps up and starts arresting or seizing the cell phone of the former president's lawyer, like, okay, this is
the Patriot Act.
But it is being fought with live ammunition, because when we write the
ammunition,
cop chopping yes. Aluminum ammunition.
Sir, continue, please.
When history is written about this, they're going to include Ruby Ridge and Waco, Texas in the chronology of this experience, right? That is a hot conflict. Right?
Well, you've also got Antifa, Black Lives Matter, and Proud Boys, and right-wing groups, and the clashes. And
totally.
Do take two to the chest.
So as you've talked about, I've talked about plenty, it's definitely fourth or fifth generation. This is exactly what's happening, where you've got disparate, decentralized groups acting in accordance, or sorry, in coherence, trying to achieve a plausible promise that can be achieved. They come together, they work towards that promise, it works or it doesn't, then they dissipate and they come back together again. We saw the network alliance this last summer between the corporations, the radical left, the BLM, and Antifa. We see a little bit of that splintering after the election, with Antifa still being like, F Biden, we want anarchy, all this stuff, but nobody paying too much attention to that part. So the Civil War is on, man. It's on.
The Patriot Act basically set the stage. I remember when that got signed and thinking, like, this is so ridiculous. Like, not, I didn't laugh, but I was like, this is so insane that now the government has the right to just, like, bust in my door and throw me in Guantanamo Bay.
They don't, but, like I said, there are people who are going to be like, there's going to be some, you know, federal agent looking at this going, man, this is crazy. Do you see the thing they assigned? And then the door opens up. Hey, Johnson, go beat the crap out of that guy and throw him in prison. You got it, boss.
Yeah, but it took 18 years. Like, it wasn't acted on for the first decade or two.
What I'm saying is they don't need it. They could go right now to the average cop and be like, brutally beat that person. And they'll say, okay. They'll just do it.
It really concerns me that they legalize that kind of thing. And then they waited like 15 years and now they're starting to do these, like, Ian, going after
Giuliani? Let me stop you again. That's irrelevant. Well, they going after Giuliani is with or without the Patriot Act.
Right.
The point is,
the political
our culture,
targets.
The community in this country, the culture in this country has been shattered a long time ago, and now you've got people saying, I don't care. I will enforce whatever you say. It's just easier that way. People wonder why, you know, just following orders in World War II Germany. Why would they do it? Because, man, people don't care. They literally don't care. There's no principle behind many of these people. Now, hold on. A lot of these cops, quit. A lot of them say, I don't want to do this. But many of them who remain don't care. And I know there's a lot of them probably conflicted, but it's not just about the police. It's about federal law enforcement. It's about people in the military who would show up and follow whatever order. Because, well, I don't know, what, you know, I don't have the information. You know, I've lived on a few different military bases, just off of Eustis, and I briefly was crashing in Fort Carson because I had family who was there. And I asked some of the lower, you know, enlisted guys and men and women, if you were given the order to shoot somebody, would you do it? And they were like, well, yeah, like, you don't have all the information. They don't give you a pamphlet like identifying the individual and what's going on. They say, stop that person now. You do. So it's not an issue. It's the banality of evil. It is not that individuals are like, I'm going to be evil today. If their boss comes in and says, go arrest Ian, they go, you got a boss.
Yeah, well, they're like, wait. They're like, hold on, sir. Is this in triplicate? Okay, it's in Triple Kid. All right, I got it.
It's like the ape. We're like ancestors of apes. We're just these like, we're really barely out of,
would
like,
you say,
the
salt water monkey bodies?
Yes. Basically, the animal kingdom, man, we're in it. We are animal. Whether we want to think of ourselves as like this evolved thinking machine that isn't an animal anymore. We're,
who thinks
we're
of themselves
animals
as that, dude? I think of myself at the top of the food chain. And that's what I think.
We're communal animals. And so we tend to follow the herd and the pack, and we go where their food is going to be. And so when they threaten to take away the money or the food, I mean, that's scary.
Well, not only that, but you touched on the realist. Social exile, social shame, fear of being excluded, fear of becoming the worst thing possible, a member of the out-group.
Because you will die alone in the world.
That's right.
Don't want to be the out-group. Doesn't even matter what the out-group is. You don't want to be it, bro.
And so as long as the cult has corporate press, no matter how much they lie, people are desperate to follow the narrative of the dude playing the Pied Piper.
Bro, you gotta give it to him, man. They won. All the media, all the institutions, all the narratives.
Big tech.
Big tech, corporations, the government, the narratives, your thought processes, your value system, everything. They won. They totally won. It will now take people willing to be part of the out-group in order to fight back against. And that willingness to be part of the out-group involves being financially in the out-group, economically in the out-group, politically in the out-group, socially in the out-group. You have to be willing to be a pariah and an independent operator in order to withstand what's happening and just to survive and maintain your sense of self and your sense of identity. But to fight back, holy crap, you need to be able to amass resources. You need to be able to amass teammates in a way that's still outside of the system. You're not gonna go down to your local college and like round up a bunch of guys that are gonna see things the way we do.
And most people are going to duck and say, I hope the fire passes overhead. And then within a few weeks, there's a burnt Christmas.
Could you imagine they're like, you're no longer allowed to have a bank, but you need to pay property taxes on your house. Can't pay, don't have money,
they're
we're
doing
gonna take your
that
house
already.
Yeah, then they seize property. So you try and be outside the system, but the system's still gonna come for you, unless you're on some distant planet, which isn't feasible at this stage of humanity.
Unless people start speaking up, refusing to participate in a game in which they know their opponents are cheating, but instead they're like, I'm good for now, I'll just shut up and just take what I can get.
You're right, speaking up is key, but also building, like, the Founding Fathers, we kind of talked about this before the show, they spent two decades writing it out, like creating
it was like a century.
Yeah, like organizing a database and a plan. So in addition to speaking up, to have the basic, technology, basically.
You know what I was really feeling jealous of earlier was like, in the old days, like the really old days, you could be like, I hate this place, I'm out of here. And you could just roll off to some wilderness.
Yeah.
There's nowhere to go now. Every place has been conquered. Every place has been
conquered. Well, that's entirely true.
What? Where are you going to go where there's lawlessness, where you could set up your own country?
I mean, set up your own country? If you're one person and you kind of want to be left alone, Mexico's got a lot of territory. Yeah. A lot of places in Mexico where you can go and kind of do your thing. There's an anarchist place. What state is that Luke loves?
Anarchapulco?
No, that's just the name of
Anarchapulco.
That's just the name of like a conference.
Yeah. I can't remember the name. Yeah.
There's a southwestern, I can't remember the name of it, but Luke is like, it's anarchy. This town kicked out the government and the cops, and now it's totally anarchy.
Well, that's cool, but they better have a lot of guns.
They do.
The narco terrorists want to roll through there and take back their power. You better be able to defend yourself.
But what do the people have that they would want?
It doesn't matter. My point is, it's like, where truly can you just go and chill?
Tell me.
Build an island.
All right, but Yukon territory. Alaska.
Yeah,
that's probably
Alaska, man.
Yeah.
You stroll up the middle of Alaska and just take a bus in there and live in an old bus and then eat the wrong colored seeds and die.
Yep.
You know that
right? So what was that movie?
Into the Wild.
Yeah.
You can go to Alaska, man. It's
Alaska.
Beautiful. Lot of fish.
Still got that fuck. Still got the FBI in Alaska.
Yeah, but they're not going to go up to Alaska and bother you. If all you do is fish all day and you mind your own business.
But if you speak up, if you're loud, they might start.
Yeah, but that's you. And like, I'm saying, if you want to just get away, you're like, I don't want to be a part of this anymore, ain't nobody's going to stop you. You can easily just go up to, you can go to the middle of Nebraska.
Yeah.
Sure, eventually someone might knock on your door and they'll be like, I'm just some dude eating the fish, like, leave me alone. They probably will.
I think there's a movement to make sure that it gets harder and harder to get a, to run away.
You still gotta pay property taxes in Alaska.
I bet. Unless you're just some dude who lives in a bus. I get it though, if you have a family. But to your point about being able to just up and leave, you can. It's just really, really hard.
Yeah.
It was really hard to get in a boat and cross the Atlantic and, you know, land on the eastern shore of the New World. It's really, really hard. Hope you brought a sword because there's some wild animals and you gotta figure out your food right when you get here. So maybe you do the same thing now.
Yeah.
I mean, look, it's not even that. Buy some land in the middle of nowhere. It's not gonna be that expensive. And Alaska pays you when you leave. I'm pretty sure that would cover your property taxes if you got like a couple acres.
But that's only gonna help you dip out. If you really wanna change the system and organize, I mean, you could do it under the radar, like with encryption and, like, you know, networks that aren't.
No, they don't even know that stuff.
You know how they did it in the old days? The old days, ancient days, like prosperous. They wrote their messages in what they call esoteric, where they would say one thing up here, but the real message was under here for the people that could parse it. And they were still able to manage, like, talking about philosophy and politics at the same time as, like, existing in a political state, where philosophy often challenges the political state, right? Because you're talking about politics, right? And this was a style of communicating that was able to mask the underlying message. We're gonna have to get better at that. That's for sure.
Let me
being 280 characters. It's like,
I'm gonna
sedition.
I'm gonna rain on the parade of everybody.
What parade? There's no parade. You're gonna rain on my funeral.
So there are people who still are like, no, you know, I'm gonna rain on the parade of those who have what little optimism left.
Oh right, okay. Let's shove those black folks down there.
Let's just make the rain. It's not just rain.
Acid rain.
It's acid rain. It's acid hail.
Stuff on fire.
It's hailing. There's lightning. The wind is kicking up. People are standing there, their skin is peeling.
Okay.
Did you know that the illegal immigrants in this country have votes represented in the presidential election?
I did not know that.
It's very simple. The Electoral College is comprised of it's basically however many states, how many representatives they have, they get an electoral vote. Illegal immigrants are counted towards representation in Congress. So when California says sanctuary state and starts bringing in as many people as possible and incentivizing it with free health care like they did for people under 26, they then say, now we have 7 million people. We'll take 10 congressional seats and 10 electoral votes, please. It works. That means, figure out how many illegal immigrants are in this country. Now, they may not be directly voting, but so long as they live in California, we're not a direct democracy. We do not win the presidency off the popular vote. So it doesn't matter necessarily if an individual casts the vote. It matters if the state chooses who to vote for. And if the state has more congressional seats because they allow illegal immigrants into the country, well, then they have is of greater likelihood that the Democratic president can win, because California has an obscene amount of congressional representation because they, not necessarily because of illegal immigration. I was actually reading Center for Immigration Studies, which the left calls like far right, and they don't say it's actually that much. It's like one extra vote, but that still matters in the context of what I'm talking about. You want to talk about a collapse in the system? You want to talk about Joe Biden going after his political rivals, you know, Donald Trump's lawyer? How long has it been that this system that you could be not a citizen and still influence the presidential election? And so what happens then, because of that simple fact, the Democratic Party is incentivized to get more congressional representation. Right now, Trevor Noah from The Daily Show has a segment where he's saying, 89 people in New York didn't fill out their census, come on, men, and now all of a sudden we lose a congressional seat. That's how important it is, and an electoral vote. It's not about, you know, voter fraud or people voting, it's about congressional representation and the Electoral College. That's what you get when you have more people.
This isn't the first time, though, that the United States has based their electoral votes on non-voting populations, right?
No, of course, right.
Yeah, slavery, obviously, is the very first good example of that. Dude, I'm feeling it. I'm feeling all that, and that's exactly why when Donald Trump proposed in the 2020 census to actually ask people who were being counted if they were citizens of the United States, that the left freaked out about that. Whenever the left freaks out about something that is perfectly rational, like, are we counting citizens here, or are we just counting every schlub that walked across the street? because it determines how many votes we have at Congress and all these things. When they're freaking out on something that's perfectly rational, then you know it's part of their game plan.
All right, I'm gonna do a 180 now. And I'm going to be a rain of sunshine on your parade.
Bring it.
The sky is clearing up. The acid rain is going away. People are now looking up at the sunlight.
I don't trust
Although
it.
Although their acid rain riddled skin is being hurt by the sunlight, they're still smiling to see it.
I'm going back underground.
No, you're gonna love this one, ladies and gentlemen. We got this amazing story. Check this out. Project Veritas has an update in their lawsuit with the New York Times, and the New York Times is ripping over themselves and taking a dump on their own credibility in a desperate attempt to stop James O'Keefe. It's glorious. So James put out an update video. The defense the New York Times is going with is that they have no idea what's going on. They didn't actually investigate James O'Keefe or his story. They didn't talk to any people involved or ask anyone for comment. It was a bunch of opinions, and they're completely ignorant of anything that happened in this case.
This is their without malice part of the argument.
But this means that James O'Keefe has just taken an axe to the face of the fake news narrative tree.
Yeah.
It is in the Veritas video, they point out how after the New York Times says this, USA Today cites the New York Times saying Project Veritas is part of the coordinated disinformation. Then you get Wikipedia, you get Twitter, Facebook, all running the same story and banning this based on the fact that the New York Times said it was true. And now the New York Times has admitted in no uncertain terms, in a court of law, one, it was just our opinion, two, we didn't actually follow up on any of this story, and three, we honestly have no idea what's going on anyway. That's malicious. Yeah. Well, malicious is a reference to knowing it's false. So what they're saying is, we're totally clueless about this story, so it can't be malice.
Maybe not malice, what would you call it?
Not legal malice.
When you just, like, fire a gun everywhere without looking, and then it hits somebody.
Yeah, negligence.
Evincing a depraved mind.
Negligence is the word I was looking for. Negligence, is that illegal? Can you hit someone on negligence?
What I love is that all these news organizations take the same tack. It's like, oh, we're not actually reporting facts. We don't actually investigate stuff. What are you talking about? We're just speculating.
It's like willful negligence. It's one thing when Tucker Carlson is defending himself in a suit and says it's an opinion show that no one should take seriously or whatever. It's another thing when the New York Times runs a fact-based news story in their main news section and has to admit to the court these are not opinion writers, these are news reporters who published in the news section unverified opinions that they did not investigate anyway.
So they're either malicious or incompetent, dumb or diabolical.
Yes.
All the things that we've been talking about for years now coming to the forefront, but guess who's going to care? Guess how much traction that story is going to get? Guess how much of an impact that's going to make in American people's minds that the New York Times admits that they don't fact check, they don't research, they don't investigate the stories that they put out as fact. How much influence is that going to have?
None.
That much, guys. That much.
It's a neck thing. You see the story of the Jeopardy contestant who did the three-pointer hand sign because he won three times and he started screaming he was a white supremacist. This poor, you know what's funny is that this guy could win Jeopardy and still not understand the context of the other
contestant.
It's like, dude, you read trivia all day. Certainly you read the news story about why you don't make that hand
sign. Because that's certainly trivial.
So Project Veritas still, this is good because it is part of the battle, and Veritas is suing Twitter as well as CNN. They're probably going to win,
yes.
And it's going to empower Veritas more, and it, at least, you know, someone is fighting back and having a good go at it. However, regular people watching CNN and the people who already like Veritas will be like, good. But it's a tool for all of you. If you're somebody who is sick and tired, if you're somebody who has friends and family, and I know it's difficult because a lot of people are like, my parents, my friends, they won't watch the stuff, they won't read the news anyway, they don't want to hear it. One more thing we can be like, oh, hey, look at that, the New York Times admits they don't actually fact check their stories. At the very least, you can do this.
Dude, they won't even believe it, though. You can read it to them, New York Times, in the New York Times, and saying they don't, they won't even believe it.
But no, it's all about how you present it. If you go to a family member, let's say you got a Joe Biden supporting family member, and you go to them and go, Biden is awful, and I'll tell you why, I can't believe you voted for him, and you argue with them, like, man, get out of here, get out of here. But if you walk up to him and you go, you see that crazy thing, that lawsuit or something? The New York Times apparently admitted they don't even fact check their stories? weird, huh? That's it.
Yeah. It's neutral. That's good.
It's just, I don't know. And then they're like, what does that mean? They're like, I don't know. I guess I'll subscribe to USA Today or something. Because, yeah. And you don't make it a big thing. You don't tie it to things. You just tell them outright. So you're sitting there and you're like, did you hear about that story the other day? Like, I guess, like, the New York Times got sued. And then they came out and just admitted their news stories have unverified opinion. They're not fact-checking. Man, that's crazy. I guess, you know, I'll probably just, you know, take a different part of it.
That's crazy, man. You know, the Washington Post, they used to do fact-checking of the president. They stopped doing that. Did you hear that?
Oh, yeah. Something with Joe Biden.
Yeah, something with Joe Biden. Joe Biden's president now. We don't need to fact-check him. Because he's not actually really saying this.
They just announced that today?
They just announced that today.
Because they don't think exactly Joe Biden.
No, it's whoever's writing his talking points, so therefore they don't need to fact-check the president. Okay, guys. Hey, George Bush went into Iraq, but you know what? It was based on the information of other people that they gave him. That doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. No one needs to be held responsible for anything anymore. Uncle Joe, Papa Joe, he's president now and everything is okay.
Yeah, okay. I love these tweets from the establishment lefties who are like, I woke up on Sunday and everything was great because Trump didn't tweet. And it's like, you open the news and it's like, Joe Biden bombed Syria or whatever.
Right.
Did he bomb Syria already? No, he didn't, right?
No, I believe that they did. And I believe,
oh, they did.
Yep, and there was also a shot fired at an Iranian ship, I believe.
Yeah.
I remember that because I tweeted that one out. I said, Orange Man made me do it.
Sorry. Biden launched an airstrike against Syria 1 month into his presidency,
right?
Yeah,
exactly.
So it's like, you know, these people are all cheering. And yeah, have you seen that commercial where the woman, she's working in a shop, and the flowers in the shop are talking to her, and she's singing, and it's like busy.
Yes.
And then the puddle goes, I'm going to put Lisa on crutches. And then everything turns back to normal, and she goes, what? And then the guy's like, you know, you got to get crutches, man. And it's, you know, an insurance commercial or something. It's a good commercial. But I see that, and it reminds me of, like, these Biden people who are now posting Biden sucks. You know, Biden voters posting their L's. There's a Twitter account for this. And it's the people who are, like, during the election going, like, yeah! And they're all, like, singing Good Morning Starshine or whatever and holding hands under the rainbow. And then a month, then they're, like, everything is dark and gloomy and awful. And there's a dark filter on the lens that makes you just feel miserable.
You know what's interesting? I thought that being right would make me feel good.
No.
It really, really
makes me feel worse.
It makes me feel worse.
It's being part of a crowd that makes you feel good.
Yes. Being right when everything's going so wrong, every step of the way, it's like,
if you have a lot of people with you, agreeing with you, and acknowledging that you're right, it helps.
Bro, I have 108,000 now people on Twitter agreeing with me largely, and it still doesn't help. It makes me feel terrible being right.
One of the greatest people in history died in poverty. They were hated throughout their lives. They were persecuted. They were, like, Socrates was made to drink poison. They weren't accepted, but that doesn't make them wrong. So maybe you're one of those people.
Well, I'm definitely not in poverty, so I'm winning. Socrates got you, buddy.
You're better than the soap.
I don't know, man. It's kind of worrying to me that we've built a culture of a society of people who are desperate to just be a part of the crowd.
You would think we'd be past that.
No. We didn't build a society that does that. That's human nature, bro. That's human nature everywhere, all across time, all across everything. Why? Because we thrive in small groups.
Yeah, but look at Sparta, dude. Those people were nuts.
Yeah, but they
had the opposite. We don't want to go that direction either. But I'm saying, like, that you can build a society that's like, I mean, they would, like, what would they do with, wouldn't they, like, test babies?
They would kill any sick babies.
No, but wouldn't they, like, hold them underwater or something?
I don't know.
Or something ridiculous where it was like, if the baby survived, it was strong enough.
Warrior.
Kids would fight in the military from age either 6 or 8 to 30. Every Spartan is in the military.
See, I'm not all about that. But we have the opposite, where it's like, you know, you've seen the opposite, right? Those that reproduce the most win. So it's like, you combine Idiocracy with WALL-E, where you have all the people just morbidly obese in hover chairs, and that's what we've been for a long time. We've been a nation of just, life's too good, too easy, no conflict, no challenge, no struggle, and it's our own, well, I'd say it's our own fault, but I wasn't alive. And I think, you know, we here on the show are, you know, trying desperately to get people to care about the future of this planet and things like that. But there are people of previous generations. I guess it's, you know, good times make weak men make hard times. maybe the hard times are going to make them strong men. The next generation that is turn around.
That American dream where they're like, I'm just going to get my own little plot of land and everyone else can screw off and I'll protect my family and everyone else goodbye.
That's not good. Because what that's done is created like this subset of plutocrats that are like, I'm going to protect myself and let the rest of society suffer.
No. The number one factor to resist tyranny is the power to feed and protect yourself. If you have land and you can feed yourself, that is the best protector against tyranny there ever was. That is why Rome, it was a big deal to have land to take care of yourself. And as soon as land owning stopped being as dispersed as it was, warriors and soldiers couldn't own land anymore, or it stopped becoming a requirement in order to be in the army. Land holding got consolidated by wealthiest aristocrats, and the people didn't have land to take care of themselves. That's the problem. In America, if everybody was homesteading, if everybody could have their own food, their own energy, their own warmth, their own land, their own security, well, that is a mighty fine resistance to tyranny.
You're saying it's like when the wealthy took away the ability of the regular people to have land and survive, they became dependent upon that system.
Yes.
So
where are you leading me, Jim?
I don't know. I'm thinking about this. I'm wondering what if the workers of the world united?
United.
Oh, I see. Workers
of the world. Okay. I knew. That was too gentle. You were just drawing me in there.
You're like, what are you doing?
No. How about this? Farmers of the world unite.
Farmers.
That's better.
I'll elaborate.
No. Hold on. See, I see. They take that statement, workers of the world unite. And it's become a bad thing because of the darkness that's behind it, the exploitation. But regular working people agreeing to defend each other from exploitation and the corrupt political elites is not a bad thing. The bad thing is when the corrupt political elite says, "Hey, we're going to get all the workers to unite. Now just do as you're told, or else."
Exactly.
That's the problem.
To clarify the American dream or whatever of having your own land and protecting heaven and how that's a problem is that I think that some people just stop there and that's it. And then they don't care about other people. And so they're okay if other people are suffering. Like, well, he arrested that guy. It's not my problem. And the isolationist mentality that kept us out of World War II, for instance. So there's more to it. Yeah, you want your own property and your own food, but you have to think about and care for others. I know. It's not like you don't want to politicize it and make people do it, but we need to do that.
What's funny is about when people do have their own land and their own sustenance and their own heat and their own protection, the need to actually engage with and care about other people and interact with them, it just decreases, right? It's that connectivity, especially with the long range distances that bring us all together into this proximity that we're not accustomed to. This is actually part of the problem.
And that's why they want everybody to have guns. So,
in the good way.
Right. You have your property. You don't really, you know. Have you guys seen you've seen the movie The Patriot with Mel Gibson?
Yeah.
What an amazing movie.
Yeah.
But the British hate it apparently because it makes them look like villains. But
the British.
It was pure propaganda.
But there's that scene where Mel Gibson's like, we're going into town, and they're like, oh, we're going into town, because you don't go into town
right.
Like you live on a farm. You work. You do nothing but work. Going to town was like a rare thing before the telephone. But so, right. It's like a mail carrier has delivered a mail and everyone gathers around. What is it? What's the message? Oh, man. Because I've been looking at chickens for 6 months. Give me something to read. But so what happens is back then, everybody needs to be ready and able to defend themselves. Because if someone starts invading your land, how will you get word out to the local militia or to the community? You got to be ready and able to defend yourself. Then when conflict starts, word will spread eventually, and then people can start mobilizing. But in the meantime, you need to be able to have to keep and bear arms.
I'm gonna agree with Ian a little bit on this one because this is actually something I've really been thinking about, and I'll explain myself.
Lame.
So hear me out. This is like the underlying idea. Okay, so this is a problem that I've actually watched. You can make fun of Ian.
I'm making fun of Ian, but I love Ian. We know this.
It's fine. Okay, let me finish. Right. Okay, so this is the underlying issue, I think, in like the Libertarian Party, and to some extent in the conservative movement, is that this idea of the individual is so much higher than every other ideal. And I understand how important that is, and I fully respect and appreciate that. That's crucial. But Ian is right that we need to have that community, and Tim just talked about that. He's like, you need to be able to defend yourself. You need to be able to gang up with other people when it's time to rise to the occasion and fight the bad guys.
That's right, a well-regulated militia.
Exactly, like that's a group, you know?
Yeah, and by regulated, I think we mean trained and equipped, right?
Functioning.
Functioning.
It doesn't necessarily mean trained. It just means functioning.
Functioning.
Yeah, so in The Patriot, I love the end where I think it's Cornwallis. He goes, he's like, what does he say? Like, are my eyes deceiving me or is it militia forming at their center? Yeah, because the militia weren't trained. They were right, but they were functional. They were, functional. They had weapons. They could follow orders. They could generally cooperate to way, but they were not trained. I gotta say, man, it's really funny when you look back at history and you're like, why would anyone fight a war that way? You know what I mean? Like marching with drummers. There was a meme on Reddit and they were like, someone said, I cannot understate the absurdity of the fact that armies had drummers marching into battle, just playing a drum. Like, dude, you're gonna die. What are you doing? Not careful allocation of resources, I guess.
That was before radio. That's how they communicated with troops.
Right.
They'd be like, turn right.
Yeah, and the horns. Yep. And the horns and the flags and all that stuff, so they knew where to go because you couldn't hear someone yell. But the crazy thing is, people need to realize this. Man, we're all really standing on the shoulders of giants. The crazy thing is that if you took the average person and dropped them, like brought them back in time a few thousand years, they certainly aren't going to be building nuclear fusion reactors or probably even very complex machines. But they know what a wheel is. They know what a gear is. They know how to make bread. I assure you. Not good bread, but you take the average person, how do you make bread? Like, I don't know, flour, water, an egg or something. They figure it out really quickly because they've seen it.
Yeah.
Whereas thousands of years ago, people would be like, what's bread? Like a regular person will be like, see that stuff? Mash it up. And they'll mash it up very poorly, mix it with some water, and then put it over a fire, and they'll get some crappy bread. But to everyone else, it would be shocking. Then they can be like, check out a wheel. There's basic things that we know simply because we've grown up in a world where we stand on the shoulders of giants. So when it comes to warfare, it seems obvious to us. What kind of moron would just march in a field very slowly and then just stand there? Why weren't they taking cover? Take it for granted.
The transition between like sword-based, you know, infantry battles and the rifle-based battles were bad ones. Look at what happened in the Civil War. Civil War, we were using old school techniques of like fronts and like storming at each other and all that with these guns and cannons
with percussion cap revolvers.
Right, and so many people died. So many people died. And I think that's one reason why we didn't get involved in World War I as soon as the other countries, because we had a very visceral memory of what it was like to use stupid ass old techniques against modern weapons. And so many people died, just like they did in World War I.
Travis, France, they would get out of the trenches and charge towards machine guns, which is the first time they'd ever been used in war. I mean, wow. The modern machine guns. And
you've seen Gallipoli? Have you seen the movie Gallipoli with Mel Gibson when he's like 18? It's about him and the Australian infantry, and they're in Turkey. It's at near the end of World War I. And it's about him as a courier trying to stop, I don't want to ruin it, trying to stop a rush coming out of the trench into the machine
guns. Oh, it's
like
1917.
Yeah.
Have you seen that movie? That movie's awesome. The whole movie is in the style of a single shot. No breaks. It follows, two infantrymen, like, going through. It's World War One. Yeah, World War One, and it's amazing. Yeah, so the camera does have cuts. They do things where, like, it goes past a tree. But the time, it's real time. Movie's amazing, and it's a similar story.
So in that regard, the fact that we're fighting our conflicts now with China and internally in a fourth or fifth generation warfare situation with economics, information, morality, emotions, all these kind of things, rather than just force on force, there's a little bit of evolution there. It reminds me of that old Star Trek, right? Where they're just like, we're at war with this planet. And, we've decided there will be this much casualties in this war. And they just send people off to their little death camps. And
Star Trek?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it was Star Trek. But they just, like, calculated the casualties and everybody had to, like, suffer. And some people just walked off. They didn't actually fight the wars. They just calculated the wars.
I don't remember that. Which series was it?
Old, like, original.
Original series?
Yeah.
Okay, maybe.
Yeah. I think someone in the chat will bring that up.
For sure.
It reminds me more, a better analogy, I think, is Zap Brannigan in Futurama, when he said that he defeated the killbots by realizing they had a preset kill limit. So he just sent wave after wave of his own men until that limit was reached, and then they stopped fighting.
Oh, yeah. Sort of like Sherman.
There you go.
Yeah.
What were you gonna say, bro? We're all looking at you. Know?
We've always used, I don't know if there's an endpoint to this, but we've always used those techniques that we have now, that we call it fifth dimensional war or whatever. There's like
iteration.
Yeah, the love of, you know, fighting
fifth dimensional
soul.
War.
Yeah, get ready.
Traveling through time and space and all fifth dimension.
Not gonna feel good.
Jack Posobiec's next book.
False flags and getting people to fight for something that wasn't real, you know, was an ancient thing, because if you can, as long as you can frenzy people into wanting to do it, that's really the
advice. Well, you know what was even easier was like, let's just go get rich, y'all. That was
like extracting wealth.
Yeah, conquests. The Vikings, that's what, dude, they just went and invaded England just to get gold chalices.
All right, now let's get back on track for a second.
Oh, right, Giuliani.
Well, no, we're talking about, we're talking about Veritas and the victory. And I want to keep raining down sunshine on people.
Oh, because yeah, please,
it started really dark. I mean, the Giuliani stuff is freaky.
Feels good now.
Ladies and gentlemen, we got a secret weapon.
Oh.
You ready for this ultimate secret weapon? It is the return of MAGA rallies. I'm kidding. It's not a secret weapon. But Donald Trump is planning, he may hold MAGA rallies beginning in May, according to a report. The Trump rallies are going to come back. And you know, I jokingly say it's a secret weapon, but it is going to start picking things back up, getting people back in focus. Maybe not, you know, there's some bad people, I guess, but the general idea is getting people to center around something, probably something better than, I don't know, just pessimism and black pills.
Yeah, I hate trashing Trump because he's not a horrible human, but I don't like him. He's the guy.
I mean.
Yep. That's right.
He's got many fatal flaws. Many. One of them is this desperate need to be liked.
Yeah.
Has to be liked. And as Darren Beattie very astutely pointed out on our last Friday sessions, check it out, youtube.com/JackMurphyLive. He was an insider, Trump insider. I also interviewed Amanda Milius at the same time, and also a Trump insider. And they both were very honest and very open and candid about the flaws of the Trump administration from the perspective of true MAGA believers who were appointed by the president, right? So this is an honest assessment as you can get. And one of the things that they drilled down on was the fact that Trump needed to be liked. And what that translated into was him saying things like, oh, everybody loves us on campus. Oh, there's no conflicts in the street. Oh, everything's great about this. Everybody loves us. Right? But at the same time, there was actually violence. You couldn't wear a MAGA hat on campus. There was actually violence at the rally. There was actually people, you know, attacking other people for supporting Trump. And so his desire, don't get excited. I truly am not excited about that. I wish I were. I wish there was a 3.0 person who was like ready to be the Trump that we really need now. But that person hasn't seemed to materialize just yet. And Trump
Santas,
you know, I just don't, I watched him in Florida. I don't know too terribly much about him. The people of Florida may not vote for him as president because they want him to stay governor. Yeah. You never know, crazy things have happened.
Trump had that star power. He was a famous business mogul. Like who, it'd be like Mark Cuban, Elon Musk, like who's a Zuckerberg, you know, some crazy, ugh. Not him, obviously.
I mean, Trump before he was president is more famous than all three of those guys. Three of those guys are now.
Yeah,
I wish. So famous. I wish Zuckerberg would have run on the Democratic ticket in 2020. You know why? Because then he would. Well, actually, I don't know if he would have won, but it would have been hilarious.
See him trying.
It would have been the worst possible thing for the people of this planet, but it would have been hilarious to have, like, you know, Zuckerberg is like a combination of Data from Star Trek and the Joker.
He looks like Data.
He
really looks like Data.
So, oh, so like Lore, basically. Well, no. In Star Trek, Lore is Data's brother. He's another, but he's like megalomaniacal.
Yeah.
That doesn't really work. No, like Data's.
They did a good twin, bad twin shtick with Data and his android.
Well, so the original, I think Lore was first. Synthetic humanoid was with emotions, and he became sociopathic.
Then
Data was created without emotions and had to like learn or whatever. But no, it's not a fair comparison. It would actually be like, you know, Data was a good person, you know, struggling and trying to learn how to become human. You take that element of the very analytical, data-driven, and combine it with the Joker, and you get much better. He was a hilarious person.
He's more powerful now.
Right, so he didn't want to do it.
Yeah. And that's a sad statement when we find out that the corporations are more powerful than the presidency of the United States. That's a problem.
You know what I love?
Libertarians, fix that.
Let me tell you, I've been laughing all day. So, you might not know this, but I actually got more heavily involved. Well, I got heavily involved in politics through just general activism when I was younger in music, and I worked in nonprofits. But there was a period where I started hanging out at hackerspaces in like 2010, 2011. So I became friends with a lot of very prominent hackers in these spaces. Hackerspaces. And at the time, Anonymous was really big, the hacker collective online, and a couple other groups like Telecomics. Some of these individuals stayed true to their data love and libertarian principles of rejecting authoritarianism. But something really interesting happened. There's a hacker convention called DEF CON, which is a very prominent, what we think is a hacker convention. It was a black hat, which is very corporate. And we were watching, my friends, some of these very prominent, well-known, famous hackers, the woke infestation, and activists started coming to hacker conferences, people who were not hackers at all, who didn't understand the culture, didn't understand the symbols, didn't understand what it's like, literally anything about hacker culture, but they liked the activism that they saw from hackers, so they started coming in. Some of these people, at the time, were very, very anti-intelligence agencies. I mean, there were people screaming and ranting about spying and all that stuff. Something really interesting happened. I think it was a few years ago. One guy was speaking at DEF CON and made a statement where he was supporting law enforcement, and the audience started clapping and cheering. And he was like, wow, never thought I would give a speech at DEF CON and have people cheer for the federal government. And they were cheering because he was speaking about Russian interference and things like that. My favorite thing all day, I've been just laughing, slapping my knee, are some of these hacktivist Antifa people that I know cheering on the FBI right now. And so I've been commenting on their pages. I'm like, I am so glad to see you've been radicalized and you're on board with the federal government. You know, I was really worried because you were very anti, you were very strict in the government when I knew you, to see you now fully on board with authority and the liberals running the government. It's a good thing. And all of a sudden their brains like,
broke them.
Did it work?
Well,
they're rebooting, we'll find out.
Right? Right? No, they'll come back with something else.
Brain broke.
There's no way to shake people free. Even with logic and their own behavior held up to them with a mirror 1 inch from their face.
It's like 1 out of 10.
It takes trauma. It takes serious trauma where you finally have to admit that your mental model of the world is not leading you into productive outcomes.
I got an idea. Here's what you gotta do, right?
Ask them
to heal. No. Go to your friends and family, right? The ones that you know are
the ones
like,
that are still talking to me?
Yeah, the ones that are, and be like, do you guys wanna go see this band play? You wanna go see a band? And then when they're like, oh, sure, like, we're gonna go out and see this big show, it's gonna be fantastic. It's gonna be this famous, saxophonist or something. And then you bring them to a MAGA rally. And then you pull up in the parking lot, you walk up, they're like, why is everyone wearing MAGA hats? Like, oh, I don't know. And then you get them in, and then they're standing there, like, what's going on? And all of a sudden Trump comes out, and then they're gonna be like, what's that? But then they're gonna see a bunch of regular people, and everyone's gonna be smiling, and then babies, and then people gonna be shaking hands, and Donald Trump's gonna be, I'm kidding, by the way, don't really do that.
Oh, I was like signing people up in my head, visioning in my mind what was gonna happen when he starts going, lock her up.
Well, I don't think he'll do that now.
Right, especially because Giuliani's gonna be in jail. Right.
We just watched earlier the Curb Your Enthusiasm where he hates the idea to wear the MAGA hat.
Yeah, it's a little MAGA.
So good. Because he has to have a meeting. Larry David has to have a meeting the guy doesn't like.
Yeah.
So he gets the idea to wear a MAGA hat, and the guy is like sitting in the restaurant. He's like, I gotta go. I don't want to be here. So then my favorite bit is when he's driving, and he cuts off the biker. And the biker is like yelling at him like, ah. So he pulls over, and then he puts the hat on, and then the biker goes, just be more careful next time, and then just leaves. That was a great show.
It was a good show. He is in unchecked, right? Like just behaving with no regard for anyone else about anything. His field OFs are fallow as F.
Indeed,
right,
yes.
Do you think? I mean, this is kind of an obvious thing. When we talked about the Giuliani thing, we didn't even mention the Hunter Biden email laptop thing,
right?
That Giuliani basically spearheaded and popularized as best as he could. Makes me think that it's a political recognition, but I still don't know any of the evidence. Maybe he did something wrong.
Dude, we sit here and we look at these facts and we're like, we're so right about everything. the insurgents bullcrap, the retribution bullcrap, the stepping on the Constitution, all these things, all the election stuff. We're like, we are so comfortable.
What do you mean?
I mean, I'm open to challenges and critique, but like, I'm pretty sure that the way we see the world is accurate. But there's another group of four sitting around right now somewhere doing a podcast right now, looking at the same fact pattern and saying a narrative completely opposite 180 of what we're saying, and they feel as secure as we do that they're right.
Sure.
This is the problem.
There's a podcast, it's called like Things You Should Know or something. Have you heard of it?
Nope.
Have you heard of it?
No. Nope.
Stuff You Should Know?
Young Genociders or something?
No. It's just like some dude sitting around. But I listened to one of these episodes, and I could be wrong about the name of the podcast, but they were talking about like climate change, and one of the guys is like, dude, like, I mean, fossil fuels are going to run out anyway. We need to start doing research. And the other guy goes, like, yeah, dude, like, there's never going to be dinosaurs. You know what I mean? And the guy's like, right, like, fossil fuels are dinosaurs, and we're not going to have more dinosaurs. And then the guy's like, could you imagine if they, like, made a Jurassic Park thing to, like, make more dinosaurs so we can get more oil? And I was like, what the? What is this? This is a top podcast. First of all, we already synthesized petroleum with algae. It's not dinosaurs. Wow.
There's lots of ways to make oil nowadays.
Yeah, you get
pressurized plastic with no oxygen.
Oh, really?
Convert it back into
oil. So I was like, these people who genuinely think petroleum is dinosaurs. Like, dude, it's not. I think it's mostly algae anyway. It's just organic matter decomposed for the most part, I believe. But regardless, it's like, I was reading an article like the week before about a breakthrough in synthesized petroleum. It's not really energy efficient to do. It's energy efficient for us to take it out of the ground because it's already been created. And maybe there's, you know, other things we can do, but there are people, when they sit around in their podcast, they talk about stuff, they're dumb.
They're dumb. They really are dumb. So no, there is no one else that's looking at the facts like we are, who should be as deservedly assured in our positions as we are in ours.
It's listen, when I talk to...
Are we the dummies?
No.
No,
we're not.
Now, I'll tell you this. We may not be correct.
Very good.
We may not be correct. It may be that we only see the surface layer of the Giuliani FBI thing, and below the surface, it could be manicky nuts. For all we know, aliens are involved. I have no idea. Top secret.
I mean, sure, it was my first reaction to be like, FBI, Department of Justice, the judge signed off on a warrant. Like, we have a system in place to make sure that nothing frivolous like this happens. So my first instinct is to be like, man, that Giuliani done F up somehow. But
what if?
But
aliens,
yes,
are holding everyone hostage.
True.
And told the judge he had to do it. Vampire aliens. Yeah. But we can actually see themselves in mirrors.
Yeah.
And they can teleport. Hey. The point I'm making is,
I'm a gorilla.
The reality is that there's confidential stuff we don't know about. I'm not saying it's justified. I'm not saying I know the story. It could very well be that, like, Mission Impossible-like team stole the vial of, you know, stole the vial of fuel from the Genesis device, and Rudy Giuliani has a laptop with a file on it and doesn't realize it. I don't know. I'm just saying, there's a lot of stuff we don't know. So we're sitting here as informed as we can be. We may be wrong about all of this stuff. For all we know, Russia is secretly at war with, you know, some country, and there's just a whole bunch of stuff going on. But I will tell you, when I listen to these other shows, I can immediately say, they never read that story. They don't know about this conflict. They don't know about that conflict. You look at the stuff with Giuliani right now. I did a segment on it on the main channel. You know what the Giuliani stuff is really about?
It said that he was advocating on behalf of Ukraine.
Syria.
Or it's about the plan.
What's going on
with Nord Stream 2?
So let me tell you my thoughts. Do you think that Joe Biden got a prosecutor fired to cover up for his son who was facing potential corruption investigation?
Sounds plausible.
What I think the issue for a lot of people is, if that's all you know, it sounds like that's what Joe Biden did. However, I think there's a more obvious reason Hunter Biden was on the board of Burisma. Gazprom has controlled a large portion of the natural gas coming into the European Union. That's through Ukraine and controlled by Russia. So U.S. and Western interests need energy companies loyal to the West, not Russia. And so there's been a series of conflicts. One, the Euromaidan protests, separatist movement. NATO and its allies, the West, the United States, want control of NATO, want control of Ukraine, so that they can control the flow of natural gas into Europe through these pipelines. Russia wants Ukraine in the Trade Federation. Separatist fight breakout. So the U.S. goes to Syria and says, maybe we can offset this monopoly by building the Trade pipeline. My personal opinion, and I'm lacking a ton of information, is that Joe Biden's intervention in the investigation into Burisma, of which there was an investigation, according to Matt Taibbi, was to protect Western interests, not because the prosecutor was corrupt. The prosecutor likely was loyal to the country of Ukraine, not the United States and European Union, and not necessarily to Russia, but the investigation into Burisma was bad for the U.S., so Biden intervenes, and his son was there incidentally because the U.S. positioned key figures who are loyal to this country. What's a guarantee? You want someone loyal to the country, you put a former CIA director, which they did, and the son of the sitting vice president. Now you know this company will always have your back, and you don't got to worry about an Assad saying, nah, I'm with Russia. That makes more sense. Rudy Giuliani starts digging up information into what's going on, and maybe could it, I'm saying, there's so much I don't know underneath the surface, but maybe what was happening was that individuals in Ukraine were giving information to Giuliani and Trump allies that would have shown the U.S. was meddling in the national affairs of Ukraine for U.S. and European interests, not Ukrainian interests, and if Ukrainian people find out about that, they will reject NATO because they don't want to live under a boot ever again. My opinion. I don't know if it's true or not because I don't have access to contact information. There's probably a bunch of other stories I haven't seen, but it is a good story.
No, that seems to make sense. Also, Tim, by the way, you, what an encyclopedia of information.
Thank God you exist.
Did you, well, so, you read and retain more than most people I've ever met in my whole life. Very impressive.
So when we talk about these lefty podcast people who are like,
dude, Shokin was not a good, you were corrupt.
And then it's like, did you read Matt Taibbi's piece on this?
No.
Why didn't you? I don't know it existed. All right, well, that's a good excuse, I suppose. I can't blame someone for not knowing, because I don't know things that, you know, there are things that just, I don't know. But Matt, man, did he nail this. When he did his investigation and he said, there was like a dozen active investigations against Burisma and this corrupt guy who fleed the country. And so to say that there was no investigation, you know, I'm gonna say this, guys, intelligence bros who are watching this show. I'm sorry, I just think you're bad at what you do. Now, hold on. You're probably really good at what you do by your standards and by relative standards, but I just think I can do a better job. Like, if you wanted to actually convince people of U.S. interests and, like, why it's important to have more energy going to the European Union, particularly because the European Union, one of its goals is to compete against China because they needed European countries unified, I mean, maybe that's the message you should have rolled with. Instead of, it's all a lie, trust the mainstream media, and then when people catch them in lies, what do? Man, if people have no, it's like, being honest is actually the best way to go about it. Insulting the intelligence of people with garbage stories and banning someone's name from YouTube doesn't solve the problem, it makes it worse. I kind of feel like the intelligence agencies were handed off to a bunch of young kids, the next generation of deep state, who are like, I don't know how to run this thing. And now it's all falling apart.
That happens every generation, I think. I've seen it happen, especially in Wall Street and finance, where like the younger guys, they figure out new investment strategies, new asset classes, and they go all crazy, and the risk management folks and the senior partners have no idea what they're doing. That's where you can make some